Hello all, a very good morning. So we will discuss a question, that is, culture is super organic. Or supra biological in nature. Actually, this is a very big debate in anthropology, wherein there are certain scholars who say that the culture is super organic or supra biological in nature, while some other oppose it. And this debate in anthropology was brought by Kroeber and Edward Sapir, wherein Alfred Kroeber, A.L. Kroeber, he says that the culture is super organic, while Sapir opposed it. But this debate is not confined to Kroeber and Sapir. In fact, this debate has preceded the time of Kroeber. In fact, it was prevalent even before Kroeber. And the first scholar who has, first scholar in modern science who has talked about this debate is Herbert Spencer. But before we move to Herbert Spencer and what he says, first let us understand what is super organic in layman terms. So in super organic, it means that culture controls human beings. So it is said that culture is organic and super organic at both the time. That means it was created by human beings, but once created by human beings, it has risen over and beyond the human beings, and now it controls the human beings, that we as human beings are just the robots of culture. We do not have our individual consciousness. We are just behaving the way culture dictates us to. It's like we do not have any individual consciousness. So every behavior that we are doing is related to culture. So it is again related to one more debate in the anthropology, that is nature versus nurture, wherein the scholars who say that culture is super organic are aligning with the nurture side of this debate. That means they are saying that whatever we are, it's because of the socio-cultural environment in which we were born and brought up. So whatever we are, our behavior is. So these debates are interconnected. So just understand, super organic means that once created by human beings, it has risen over and above the human beings, and it controls the human being. So it's very similar to natural and supernatural. So natural are those things that obeys the laws of nature, and supernatural are those things that do not obey the law of nature. Okay, that is over and beyond the nature, and it basically controls the nature. So whenever we say that supernatural forces are there, that means it is controlling the nature. Nature is the one which is determined by the whims and fancies of the supernatural powers. That is what we believe. In the same way, it's organic and super organic, where we believe that the culture being super organic controls the human being. We individuals have no control over our behavior. So this is just in short the meaning of super organic. And now coming to Herbert Spencer. So Herbert Spencer, so he says that human beings, human society or culture is super organic. That means that he was a sociologist. So according to him, society and culture were one and the same. At that point of time, there was no distinction between society and culture. And that's why he says that human society and culture is super organic, and human beings are merely the product of civilization that they are born and brought up to. Okay, so human beings are nothing but product of civilization. Actually, Herbert Spencer, he gave this theory, or he made this statement against the theory that was called as the great men theory. So great men theory says that history is nothing but biography of the great men. Okay, so whatever we are reading in history are the great extraordinary achievements or extraordinary feats done by the great men. So this great men theory says that there are six types of great men, like kings, priests, poets, men of letters, prophet. And so these kinds of great men were used to exist, and history is just the achievement or extraordinary feat done by this great men. Herbert Spencer went against this theory, saying that great men are nothing but the product of civilization that they were born and brought up. So they were nothing extraordinary individual. There was nothing extraordinary in them as an individual, as a person. But since they were born and brought up in that specific socio-cultural environment, and that is why they were able to do such kind of extraordinary feat. So here Herbert Spencer is emphasizing that it's the socio-cultural environment in which you were born and brought up that determines your behavior, not the extraordinary feat that you as an individual carry with you. Okay, or there is nothing extraordinary in the individual. Okay, so this is the first time this scholar Herbert Spencer has highlighted this fact that culture or society is super organic. Although created by individuals, but at certain point of time, it starts to dominate over the individual. Okay, so here Herbert Spencer says that the universe or earth can be divided into three realms. And these three realms are inorganic, organic, and superorganic. So inorganic constitutes of the basic elements like carbon, hydrogen, oxygen. And to understand the interaction between these elements, we have a different science, that is chemistry or physics. So inorganic aspects of the earth can be understood by different sciences like chemistry and physics. But when these elements combined in a specific form and they basically constitute DNA, RNA, these kind of molecules. So here we cannot study the same interaction between them by using the science of physics and chemistry. We need a different science, that is biology. Okay, although I know that DNA is made up of so and so elements, or so and so elements make up the nucleotides and also the nitrogenous bases and all that stuff. But can we generate DNA from the scratch elements? No, it's not possible. So here Herbert Spencer says that whole is greater than the sum of its parts. That means even if we have these parts, we cannot create that whole. So here we need a different science to study the organic aspects of the society. So here the different science will be biology. Okay, so here physics, chemistry will not be there. So in order to study the organic elements, we have to study with biology. Now when several human beings come together, they communicate symbolically, like the way elements were interacting. Now the human beings are coming together, they communicate symbolically, they are interacting with each other. Now they will be forming a different thing. Again, he uses this statement that whole is greater than the sum of its parts. So you cannot study individuals, rather you need a different science to study the collection of individuals. And that different science will be called as by next scholars as anthropology. That will be studying the culture that will be born out of the interaction of the individual. So this debate is again connected to another debate, that is anthropology a science? Because the people who believe that culture is super organic will definitely believe that culture being super organic will be a different entity and will have a different laws of its own that will be studied by a different science, that will be anthropology. Okay, so here he says that when human beings interact together, they will to study them, there will be a different science, there will be different laws of their interaction. Okay, so then something that will be made up will be super organic in nature. The culture will be super organic. So here this Herbert Spencer has rest his debate. Then it was followed up by another scholar, that is Emily Durkheim. Durkheim, he gave the concept of social fact that bonds that comes out due to human interaction for the stability of the society. So social fact is what he defines as, it's a way of thinking, behaving or acting that is external to us but has an element of coercion attached to it. That means we have to behave in certain manner, and this force, this pressure is not internal. It's not because of our genes or it's because of our body. It's because of some external pressure that we as an individual face because being a member of the society, being a member of that group. So that makes us behave and act, behave or think in a specific manner. Okay. And then if we do not do it, so Durkheim attaches that there is an element of coercion attached to it. So that coercion will act against us. So if we don't do it, society will punish us, we might be outcasted, and we fear that coercion. And that's why we will be behaving in that same, we will be behaving in the way society expects us to behave. So this is the social fact. That means my individual consciousness is not there. Whatever I am doing, it's because the society wants me to behave in that manner, else I will be coerced, else I will be punished. And I fear that punishment, I fear expulsion from the society, that's why I am behaving in that manner. Okay, so here Durkheim says that this social fact generates what is called as collective consciousness. Everybody is thinking in the same form. Everybody is thinking in the same manner. There is no individual consciousness, but collective consciousness is there. And again, he has minimized, or basically he has reduced the effect or presence of individual consciousness in the individual. That I, whatever I am doing, however I am behaving, it's not because of my consciousness, it's not my rational decision, it's only because the society wants me to behave. Knowingly, unknowingly, I am behaving all because of the society or the culture, whatever society or culture dictates to me. Okay, then this was later on carried forward by Kroeber, who says that yes, culture is super organic in nature. And here he says that man has two aspects. The first one is the organic substance, and the second is the blank tablet. Two aspects of human, a man is there. One is the organic substance, which he refers to the body. Okay, so this is the hardware. And second is the blank tablet, which is some, in a layman terms, we can say the brain. Okay, and this body is dependent upon, the body will behave in such a manner as what is written on this blank tablet. Similar to, you have a computer, you have an hardware. So the computer will behave as per the software that is installed in it, the operating system that is installed in it. So whatever is written on this blank tablet will determine the course of action of this organic substance. This is what Kroeber says. That so, and this blank tablet will be filled up by culture. So in this society where we will be enculturated, where there will be our primary socialization, that will fill up our blank tablet. And this, whatever is filled up on the blank tablet, will determine how our organic substance is going to react, how we are going to behave, how we are going to react to certain kind of circumstances or certain stimuli that will be imposed upon us. Okay, so this is what Kroeber is saying. There he highlights that parallel chains of inventions that has happened across the world. That means several inventions happened simultaneously across the world by two different scholars, two independent inventors, irrespective of any kind of communication. They were doing the same research, and they discovered or invented the same thing at the same time. For example, oxygen was discovered by Priestley and a scholar named Scheele. Telephone was invented by Graham Bell and Elisha Gray. Then theory of evolution was given simultaneously by Darwin and Wallace. We all have seen it. So Kroeber says that how come they have done the same research at the same time? So Kroeber says that these people are merely the product of their civilization. That means their culture at that point of time was ready for this kind of discovery, and then they led to this kind. Then basically since the culture was ready, so these people, they invented or they discovered such kind of things. So they were belonging to similar kind of culture, and that's why they did the same kind of thing. So Kroeber says that individual organic endowment cannot affect civilization. So yes, civilization definitely have a hand or dominating hand over the individual, while individual organic endowment, that means individual body, if you have some special skills or some special body built or nothing, it cannot create an effect as big that it can affect the civilization. So he says that individual are merely the product of civilization. Okay, so there is no individual faculty of genius. Every individual is unanimously the product of culture or civilization that he has been born and brought up. So always emphasizing the same fact. Then comes another scholar, that is Leslie White. Very interestingly, he uses different term that is called as suprabiological. He takes up this debate again with respect to this parallel inventions. So he says that Newton and Leibniz, they invented calculus. He says that still Newton and Leibniz, although they have invented calculus, but the calculus would have been invented even if these people would have died as an infant. So if Newton would have died as an infant, or Leibniz would have died as an infant or a child, still the calculus would have been made. It's not like that if Newton would have died an infant, we wouldn't have seen calculus till now. He says that even if Newton would have died as an infant, or any of these inventors, they would have died as a child, still we would have got the inventions or discoveries in the same time. Okay, so this is again, he highlights that it's not because of the individual faculty of genius that inventions were made. Rather, it was because of the culture in which they were born and brought up. So he says that these discoveries that happened by these scholars, it would have happened because of the inevitability of evolution of culture. He says that, Leslie White, that this discovery we cannot predict whether when the innovation will occur or who will be the innovator, but I can predict for sure that innovation is going to happen because of the inevitability of evolution of culture. The culture definitely has to evolve and the next discovery definitely has to come, but I cannot predict the time, nor can I predict the name of the innovator. But what I can predict is definitely this innovation is going to happen. So at some point of time, when the culture will be ready, culture will be at that stage, that is, it's ready to accept that kind of innovation, definitely that innovation will happen. So once, explaining Leslie White, he says that 100 years back, we wouldn't have thought of something like mobile phone. But today, mobile phone is something that is with everybody. Okay. But 100 years back, if somebody would have told someone that there will come a time that everybody will be carrying a cell phone, anybody could have connect with anyone from any place. Okay, you don't need a wired telephone also. So people would have laughed at him. Okay, or if somebody would have explained about video conferencing, that such kind of technology would come 100 years back or maybe 200 years back, people would have laughed at him. So this is Leslie White saying that, okay, that culture evolution is inevitable in nature. And that's why, due to inevitability of evolution of culture, innovations are definitely going to happen. I cannot predict who will invent or when will be the innovation, but the moment culture is at that stage that it's ready to accept that invention, that innovation is definitely going to happen. And these people who are the innovator are merely the neural link through which culture evolution is going to happen or new discoveries will be happen. They do not have anything extraordinary in their body or in their mind, but they are merely a neural link through which the cultural evolution will happen, through which the culture synthesizes itself. This is what Leslie White says, that these people do not have anything extraordinary. Very similar to what Kroeber, what Emily Durkheim and Herbert Spencer have said. So this is the one side of the debate wherein the scholars are highlighting that it's not individuals who are extraordinary, but it's because of the culture that they are able to perform or do such kind of feat. And even if these individuals would have died as an infant, such innovations or inventions would have happened. It was because of the culture or civilization that they were born. One statement that I forgot to quote, that Leslie White says that had these people or these inventors or discoverers been born and brought up as a swine herders, can we expect the same discoveries from them? If Newton would have born in a swine herder family, would he be able to give us the laws of motion? Okay, or if Darwin would have been born in India, okay, in some tribal family, would he still be able to give that theory of evolution? So he just wanted to emphasize that it's not because of Darwin some unique quality. It's because Darwin was born in that culture. That's why he was able to discover or give that theory of evolution. Or Newton was able to give laws of motion. And they wouldn't have been able to give the same laws of motion or anything near to it had they been born in some other culture or had they been raised as a swine herders. This is what Leslie White quotes. So again, emphasizing that individual is nothing. Okay, it's the culture that dictates the behavior of individual. Okay, so this is the one side of the debate. Then comes the other side of the debate that opposes it. Okay, that opposes the fact that the individuals are merely the robots of culture. So the first scholar we are going to see is Alexander Goldenweiser. Goldenweiser says that it is true that definitely in universe everything has a cause, or whatever we are doing, whatever our behavior is, definitely it's because of some reason. Okay, it is because of some cause. But in anthropology, we are specifically studying, or we are focusing on anthropology of single civilization. When we are studying any society, we basically are focusing only on the anthropology of single civilization or single culture. And then he says that by doing this, we basically are ignoring several factors that would have acted upon the individual, but we are ignoring them because we are focusing only on the premise of that particular culture. Rest all the factors that are beyond that geographical area but still would have acted upon the individual are ignored. And that is why he says that the culture is not super organic, because the factors which have influenced the behavior is ignored by the anthropologist. Okay, these extra factors, they are not taken into consideration by the anthropologist. Second reason he says that individuals are historic and concrete. Historic and concrete means, yes, definitely, historically he means that definitely some historical experiences shape our behavior. Okay, so there is no point, no harm in saying that our historical experiences or our culture definitely shapes our behavior, some influence is there. But saying about concrete, he says that individual consciousness is there, that is why they are concrete as well. Okay, so whenever an individual makes any kind of innovation or discovery, he injects certain particular characters which are individual in nature, which are unique to that individual. So these individual innovations definitely are due to some unique characteristics that are related to a particular individual. That particular individual might be intelligent, that particular individual might be more fit or more appealing or anything, something which is very specific, which is very unique to that individual. And that's the reason that these individuals were the one who got lucky enough to discover or invent anything. So he says that when an individual invents anything, he injects that particular individuality or particular individual unique trait into that innovation. Okay, it's not merely the culture that is making the individual behave in certain manner. Okay, and the third thing, what Alexander Goldenweiser says, that we anthropologists, we believe that culture is super organic, or most of the anthropologists, they believe that culture is super organic. It's only because the society that we studied are simple. Simple societies ko study kiya hai humne. And that's why we believe that in those simple societies, the individual's achievement were not taken into consideration or were not that important. And that's why we started to believe that individual is irrelevant. So it's because of our area that we choose to study. So it's the simple society, and in simple society, individual have no individual identity, or their innovations or achievements are not valued. And that is why we started to believe that individual has no individual consciousness, and everything that he does is because of the culture or society that he belongs to. But Alexander Goldenweiser was a unique anthropologist because he used to focus upon the individuals even in the simple societies. In fact, he always used to write obituaries about the informant of the simple society. So whosoever has acted as an informant for his fieldwork or participant observation, he used to write obituary of every informant that he has met during his fieldwork experiences. And that's why he says that, yes, these individuals, although they belong to the same societies or one culture, but not everybody was as intelligent, not everybody was as good or as appealing than these informants, because they were the one who understood, or they acted as a bridge between the two cultures, one where the Alexander Goldenweiser belonged and the one which the culture which he was studying. So this is what Goldenweiser had to say about that culture is not super organic. Now the next one is what was said by Sapir, Edward Sapir. So again, he has repeated the same thing that was said by Goldenweiser, but he says that Kroeber, he highlights the fact by Kroeber, that Kroeber says that anthropology is unique, or anthropology is a discipline that is distinct because of its distinct entity that which is studying. Like Kroeber says that anthropology is studying a distinct entity, that is culture. But Sapir says that anthropology is unique not because of studying a distinct entity, that is culture, but of its distinct outlook. So anthropology is unique due to distinct outlook with which it studies culture. The way we are studying culture, the way we are trying to analyze culture is distinct from rest all of the discipline. The way we are trying to comprehend the participant observation, emic observation, what we are trying to do, or in-depth study, what we are trying to do, or holistic studies, that is what makes anthropology unique, not the subject of our study. Because he says that this is something subjective. So super organic is a very abstract term. And there is no reality in it, because the subject that you are studying or the thing that you are trying to study is self-constructed by the anthropologist itself. So whatever we are referring to the culture of some other society is something what an anthropologist has labeled as culture. It's not something objective in nature. So I felt that he is doing so because of his culture. Somebody else might say that he is doing so because he is scared. So it's because of the anthropologists, they have given certain or labeled some things or some phenomena as culture, and that is why we are saying that it's super organic. But culture is in fact an abstract reality, nothing objective is there. In fact, anthropologists have themselves constructed the subject which they are studying. And that's why he says that since the subject what we are studying is itself subjective, we cannot say that anthropology is, culture is super organic in nature. Okay, so let's make it more simple at the end of this debate. This is what they have said. So just to tell you in a very trivial manner, if I say that culture is super organic in this coaching scenario or in this UPSC exam point of view, so I would say that if you score a good rank in UPSC, the people who say that the culture is super organic will say that it's only because of the coaching institute that you joined. Okay, you joined my classes or you joined somebody else's classes, you were able to score good marks. Okay, you were working hard only because you had such environment, only because you were sitting in the cream. Okay, but if somebody who do not agrees with this point of view saying that culture is not super organic will say that you qualified, it's because of your unique talent. But the reality is in somewhere in between these two extreme poles. Okay, so this is it for today. Thank you so much.
Hit the bell icon to never miss an update from Level Up IAS. Make sure you like, share, comment, and subscribe to our YouTube channel.